Welcome to Snatch Talk. Oh, hello there. I'm the Velvet Snatch, and I was back in business behind the scenes at week 3 of Drag Idol 2023. We're well in the thick of it now, with only 10 competitors left, and the return of last year's most controversial addition to the competition, Teams Week. The way it works is that each contestant is teamed up with another, and they have a week to put together a joint performance. It may sound easy, but this is where we see which competitors don't play well with others, and where geographic distance or lack of joint rehearsal time can trip up even the best of performers. Would that happen this week? Well, you'll have to wait and see. As usual, we were joined by our sensational set of judges, Ophelia Balls, Plastique, Penny T. Oh, who's that bloke? Well, it was Penny T, but not as we've seen them before, since it was both their birthday and they were unluckily suffering from food poisoning. They'd thought it best to keep it casual for the night, and so would be judging the competition dressed like Ricky Gervais with some Poundland bifocals. It's a step up from Jimmy Cranky, though, I'll give it that. Next, and for 1 week only, our special guest judge and 2018 winner Gladys Duffy, who'd come, in her own words, dressed as a Beryl highlighter. Let's hope she doesn't dry out before the end of the show. Gladys also took the time to welcome to the stage another local icon, Jasmine Dick, who, while they're not in the competition this year, was in the audience to show support. And of course, would it really be Drag Idol without the legend herself, Miss Rory, who, as could be expected, had some choice words for Penny.
She's got food poisoning. I thought, well, if that's not a sign from God, I don't know what is. Kills have pies here.
But of course, wouldn't let her go without wishing her a happy birthday.
Yes, but it is your birthday, so happy birthday. And you've not even had any cake or anything, have you? So yet again, the signs keep coming, Penny. I don't know what else you need, like a bowling light from the sky or something like this. But anyway, it's nice seeing a very happy birthday, Mike. Penny, happy birthday.
So, with the judges all accounted for, it was time for the competition to start. But not before I spoke to Judge Balls. Nope, that really doesn't sit right. Judge Ophelia, about what she was expecting from the night. Hello there, I'm the Velvet Snatch and I'm here with the wonderful Ophelia Balls. How are you feeling about tonight, Ophelia?
Well, I'm excited. I do like a twosome, as you know, and they're going to be doubling up. So we've got 10 going down to 5. All very, very iconic, which is, I'm really looking forward to seeing this because I'm looking around and trying to guess who's doing what, but not too much. I've guessed 2 lots, but I don't want to guess anymore. I want surprised.
Yeah. I mean, this was the competition. This was the theme that tripped a lot of people up, like last week. Is that the intention this year? Last week, last year. There we go. It feels like last week. It was so.
We just want something slightly different because people go, oh, it's Disney week. Oh, it's this. Oh, no. People got no idea what's coming. Even Adam, well, I do know what's coming next week. Yeah. And again, it's slightly different to last year. Yeah. So we're just mixing it up just to keep people on their toes.
Well, I think that's the thing, though, because everyone was like preparing too much and they were like, oh, here's my Disney week number. Here's my Icons week number. Here's my, and now going, here's my Icons week number. Oh, and I have to do it with someone else. Oh, you know, it's
just stand in the corner while I do my number. That,
And if they do that, I assume they're going home.
Well, that's it. So we've got 5 lots. So we've got like 10 people performance. So we've got like 5 performances and then we need to narrow it down. So we've got the bottom 2.
Yeah.
Which will be 4, and that's all I'm going to say for now.
Right, okay. Yes. I'm excited about this. But how are you feeling about the competition as a whole?
I was just saying before, I think there's a lot of younger entrants this year, which is good. I'm happy that we've got younger people in because it shows that there's a keen interest in drag, as drag's in everybody's front rooms these days. And I'm enjoying it because there's a lot of younger people and dynamic people. And when we had the first night, it was quite disappointing. We all felt to send so many home, you know, it was, but we feel as though we kept the right people in.
Yeah. I think that's it. It's always like I was saying to Plastique earlier, like I couldn't have sent anyone home last week. So I'm glad I'm not a judge, because I would have just been like, oh, go on, we'll just keep them in. And you kind of wonder like how many weeks you can do that until they're like, we kind of need to get rid of some of them.
I know, we've actually changed it up tonight. We were going to get, see, I can't say anything because it hasn't happened. The ending has changed compared to what we decided last week. I've had a phone call today and the ending has slightly changed. So we're still, someone is still going home, or people are still going home. You'll have to wait and see. But yeah, it's up in the game. It's keeping people on their toes.
Yeah. Oh, amazing. Thank you so much for speaking to me, Ophelia.
You're welcome. Lovely to see you. And you're looking gorgeous. Enjoy the show.
Thank you, Ophelia. Now, on with the show. The theme for the night was icons, and the first contestants we had up were Cherry Bomb and Elastique as Team Elle of a Lot of Cherries, with a burlesque-themed number. But it seemed like Ella, or is that Christina, was having trouble. Cherry wasn't having any of it, though.
She's not unbelievably talented, she's not beautiful.
But gave Ella a second chance to prove herself. Which, with some careful encouragement, saw the protege upping her game. Gladys loved the Dance Moms references and said that the spoken word sections were on point. However, she'd wanted to see more of the choreo at the end. Penny agreed, describing it as a stellar performance and that she'd liked how Cherry had stripped her dancing back a bit to incorporate Ella into the number. Rory, however, felt that the build-up was too long for the payoff, and Plastique agreed, but pointed out that the two had seemed to bring the best out of each other. It did seem, though, that each of the judges had a different opinion on how the track could have been edited, and herein is one of the big hurdles of Drag Idol. You have 3 minutes for your number, no more, when the judges are pressuring you to tell a story while still wanting you to show off your dance, comedy, singing, naked parkour skills. You've got to know how to edit it right, and all too often we get contestants that don't know how to pace or edit themselves. I mean, that's how we ended up with the 3 minute limit in the first place. Christ. I'm going to be honest, it was an all right number. However, and I can't believe I'm saying this considering I've seen corpses that move with more fluidity than me, even when Ella's dancing and lip sync was supposed to be improved at the end, I still think it could have been tighter, and I hear that a lot. Up next were Team Dripping, aka Dildo and Satin Addict, with a number about SpongeBob SquarePants becoming a stripper. Well, if that's not an indication that the edibles have kicked in, I don't know what is. It was wonderfully surreal, with Satin as Patrick offering to teach SpongeBob the ropes by taking them to Booty Camp. It was nicely funny, with little bits of dildo humour scattered throughout. I can't believe I've just written that. And we're back to Jasmine Dick, I guess. Penny described it as high energy camp, stating that the squeaking tits killed her and that it was nice to see the fun side of Satin. Rory agreed, stating that Satin and Dildo could have been chalk and cheese, but instead it was like a cheese board. But while Satin's lip sync was off a little, Dildo was wonderful and she couldn't praise her enough. Plastique felt that Satin got a little lost, and while it was a great number, they would have liked to have seen more of a Satin stamp on it. Gladys disagreed though, pointing out that while we hadn't seen it previously in the competition, Satin does have a silly streak, and that it was wonderful to see them bringing a different side to themselves each week of the competition. Giving them the opportunity to speak for themselves, Satin said they'd enjoyed the experience and working together, and Dildo said,
"Horrible."
Well, you really should watch the performance on the full video, not least to see Dildo being the pure embodiment of selling a number. You'll notice that throughout all of her performances, she oozes confidence, and, like I said last week, that kind of conviction will make the audience buy in more. In her heart, she could be terrified and nervous as all hell, but she's not going to let it stop her entertaining you. one that I'd been looking forward to was next. Dixon Stones and Aya Quinn as Toy Story themed Bottoms of the Toy Box. The pairing of Dixon's messy craziness with Aya's calculated perfection could be an absolute disaster, or it could be something special. Well, what was it to be?
Oh, my string bars!
I still have no idea, but I loved it. From digs at non-binary Judge Plastique. To reoccurring gags such as Andy coming back onto the stage. I'm not going to lie, it was absolute messy, unpolished chaos, but it was hilarious. And while it did feel like Dixon had the biggest stamp on it, fair play to Aya for coming out of their comfort zone and keeping up with the madness. The audience loved it, and the judges loved it too, with Plastique, Gladys, and Penny each giving it a standing ovation. Rory described it as absolutely wonderful, pointing out the differences between the two of them, but how they were both very, very clever. Plastique proclaimed it as a contender for their favourite number of the competition so far, asking whether Aya and Dixon could maybe do the whole competition together, and saying that they brought the best out of each other. While Penny was proud of Aya for going bigger, describing the number as 10 out of 10, an over-the-top absolute fuckery. It was time for our long-distance pairing next, Team Ruby's Costalot, aka Costa Fortune and Ruby, and they'd had to coordinate their efforts between Gateshead and Leeds, but before we see whether it paid off or not, I spoke to them upstairs to see how they were feeling. Hello, I'm here with the fabulous Costa Fortune and Ruby. How are you feeling tonight, girls?
Yeah, really excited. I think there's some good concepts. I think it's just going to be a camp shit show.
I'm feeling very excited. I think we're two like staple characters. Could go anywhere. I'm excited for what's going to happen. We've blended styles quite well, I
definitely
think.
She's taught me to dance and I've taught her how to be funny. It's been difficult. No, I'm only joking.
How dare you?
It was like, I was very happy with the pairing. I won't lie.
Same.
I mean, you were one of the ones that I was kind of worried about because obviously the distance with you living in Leeds and Costa living in a bin, it's, you know.
I've been, it's spacious. It's more of a skip. Let's be polite.
I dream of living in a skip. Oh, luxury.
That'd be gorgeous. I think we've dealt well with the distance, like messaging every day.
FaceTiming, and then I got driven up early today, and then it's just
we had a good rehearsal time today.
Did you get face-to-face today?
Yeah, we had a couple hours together today.
I was like,
We are not leaving until it's sorted. But no, I'm very excited. We've rehearsed. We're just going to do it. We think it's camp. Hopefully the judges do as well. I'll do whoever it takes.
To be fair, one of the judges this week is Gladys Duffy, and I think this is the perfect number for her. Like, I think she's going to respond really well to it.
We love Gladys.
Oh, we love Gladys. Honestly, the goal tonight is to be mentioned in her number of naming all the drag queens.
I'm already
you bitch.
Yeah.
Hopefully she'll remember you this year as well.
It's weird that it's a mark of honour as well to get mentioned in it. And you go like, we have a lot of drag queens in the Northeast.
It was just like an offer to Theresa May for me. Honestly, she got bloody drag race, who cares about her? But no, yeah, very excited. Very excited for Gladys to be a guest judge as well.
Yeah. So thank you so much for speaking to... Thank you so much for speaking to me, and hopefully it'll go well.
Yeah, fingers crossed. Thank you for talking.
So, how the Scooby-Doo did they do? Well, it was the essence of camp, with Ruby as short-sighted sleuth Velma, and Costa as acceptable ginger Daphne. I think out of all the performances we'd seen so far, this was the most dedicated to their source material, from the outfits, references to the cartoon, the live-action movie.
I'm a black belt now. I've transformed my body into dangerous weapons.
Velma losing her glasses.
Jinkies! My glasses! I can't see without them!
And of course, an unspoken lesbian love tryst. Spicy! The ideas were all there, but the execution was, dare I say, clunky, with the physical interactions between the two of them a bit awkward, and the edit not as punchy as it could have been. Plastique summed it up well, pointing out that the number was neither of their best, and that they'd suffered as victims of geography by not having much time to rehearse together, admitting that maybe their expectations for the pair had been too high. Begrudgingly, Penny agreed, calling it not a bad number, but that she felt herself drift away a bit. Even Gladys was on the fence, saying that any other week they'd be fine, but that she knew they could do better than that. Rory, however, ever the voice of dissonance, disagreed with the others, stating that she enjoyed the story arc and that it was executed very well, giving the pair the benefit of the doubt because of the distance. Our final duo was set to hit the stage next, Vic the Prick and Airy Asscheek in character as dangerous outlaw lovers Bonnie and Clyde. Before they hit the stage, however, I caught up with them to see how they'd prepared for their biggest heist yet.
Hello, I'm here with the astonishing Airy Asscheek and Vic the Prick, who are coupled together for this week. How are you feeling about it?
Do you know what, right? Working, oh, shall I leave you? Working.
Hey!
I'm stepping on these toes already. That is awfully large.
That's my last, so I'll be very careful.
It's large and he knows how to use it. My kind of man. How are you feeling about tonight?
Working with Vic has been iconic, to say the least. I'm really, really looking forward to it because, you know, I think we're really prepared. It's been really interesting to explore a character that's maybe not towards a dancey musical theater background. And we had ideas, we had to scrap them, but this idea I think really fits for us. And I'm really excited to perform it. So yeah.
Yeah, me too.
Yes.
So Vic, how would you describe the number tonight?
Gangster.
We're back to Buzzcocks again, like proper gangster.
What else? It's got sex, it's got violence,
true
it's
love.
Got it's
Basically
got
true love.
Love.
It's, you know, I mean, that's what this is true love.
Yeah, and she's just in character all the time. And we were really determined this time to really tell a story. Like, we need to tell. Sorry,
we're telling our story.
We're telling our story, and we've tried to be as accurate with details as possible, you know, the era, what actually happened. But we've obviously gave it a comedic kind of twist. So yeah, I hope we pull it out of the bag.
We will.
Mm.
So how has your method for putting a number together changed working together for this?
I think being together, we've been able to kind of explore each other's ideas, because you know how I was saying last week how with me I can sometimes be a bit like, we're doing this, that's that. This time we were able to be like, right, no, that's, we could do a bit better than that, and oh no, this doesn't work, this does work.
We really work together as a team. That's what we are.
We really have.
Like, it's Bonnie and Clyde against the world. It's us against the world. And that's what this is. And that's what we've done.
Yeah.
That's what we've created. Like,
and as well, I think we've really bonded because not only have we like made a really funny, good piece, but I feel like, I thought you just went. But we've really bonded and we've really spoke about our similar experiences with hardships and stuff like that, and we've really bonded in that way. And I don't, do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's more than just, oh, we've got together, we've done a number. It's really, I think it's fated that we got put together. I really do.
Absolutely. I'm a lucky man. Like, she's one hell of a girl.
No, I'm so excited to see what you come up with. No, have a wonderful night and good luck in the competition.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
To say their performance was brilliant would be an understatement. It felt like the culmination of all the skills we'd seen throughout the night. It had story, comedy, dance, and dare I say it, sex. Mm. The two of them really worked well together, in both the physicality of the performance, to the humour, to the music choices throughout. I don't want to sound sycophantic, but from what Aries said to Candy last week about really wanting to win, from the dedication we saw here, I think they mean it. The performance earned them a standing ovation from every judge. Gladys drew attention to how well the duo held the audience's attention, with dramatic moments of the performance leaving the room audibly silent, and that's unusual for Switchbar. Plastique praised them on the beautiful synergy, describing the performance as masterful, and pointing out something that I hadn't noticed, which was when Vic put a mint in his mouth before kissing Airy, as a sign of consideration for his team partner. Penny continued the praise, saying how we'd seen Bonnie and Clyde before, but not like that, praising the combination of performer and storyteller, and the attention to detail. Rory took it further, stating that it was absolutely everything, and that's how you do it. Describing the two as a pairing made in heaven, like carrot and cake, cheese and cake, crumpets and butter, Fred and Rose, no, wait, Fred and Ginger. Oof, that's some high praise from the judges, but it was well deserved. They'd rehearsed a lot with each other, and it showed. With that, however, it was time for the judges to make some decisions to which two teams would end up in the bottom and have to lip-sync for their lives. But we're heading into spoiler territory here, so if you haven't watched the full show yet and you don't want to know which teams had to duke it out and who went home, please remember to like, subscribe, comment, share, and stop the video. Take a moment. Maybe use the spare time to make friends with some woodland creatures and teach them naughty words like bum and tit. Ooh. For those of you that are still watching, here's what happened. After asking all the contestants back to the stage, it was time to find out which team got performance of the week and, as we can probably expect, it was Vic the Prick and Airy Ass Cheek for their brilliant Bonnie and Clyde number. But who else was safe? Well, after Ophelia milking the moment for all it was worth, it was Dixon Stones and Arya Quinn, and Dildo and Saturn Addict going through to week 4. Sadly, that left two teams remaining, and the rules were pretty cruel. After working closely together for a week, each contestant would have to lip-sync battle against their teammate, with the judges deciding who was the winner, with the loser of each going head-to-head to see which single contestant would be leaving the competition. As Chris came out with his carrier bag, a contestant from each team had to draw the song that they'd be lip-syncing to. For Costa and Ruby, it would be Lady Gaga and Ariana Grande's Rain On Me, which, if you'll remember from last year, was the song that sent both Peer Pressure and Reese Spectrum home. Let's hope the curse doesn't continue this year. Although, I must say for a DJ, Chris Howe only seems to have about 4 tracks to work with. Although, if it was up to me, I'd have them doing the boardroom scene from Mommy Dearest.
Don't fuck with me, fellas!
As for Ella and Cherry, they'd be battling it out to Lady Marmalade. But it was Ruby and Costa first, and there was everything at stake. Honestly, it was pretty evenly matched, with both of them familiar with the song, Costa giving it a little more energy, but Ruby giving it a little more conviction with the lip-sync and their dance moves. There were some slip-ups, of course, but no one watching could say that they were not entertained. When the battle was done, it was up to each of the judges to say who they wanted to win, and with the exception of Plastique, Ruby was the name on their lips. Now, on the night, I found myself looking at Costa more during the lip-sync and didn't really agree with the judges, but watching it back, I wonder if maybe I agree. But who would be battling Costa Fortune to stay in the competition? Well, it was up to Cherry Bomb and Elastique to fight it out next. I'm going to be honest here, this did seem like a foregone conclusion, with anyone coming up against dance sensation Cherry in for a hard time. Even worse, it did seem like Ella didn't know the words. She tried her best and held her own, but Ella wasn't who the judges wanted to win, with all 4 voting for Cherry to stay on in the competition. With that being done, it was time for the final round. Costa Fortune versus Elastique, battling it out to see who got through to week four. The song was Tina Turner's Proud Mary, and oh, my little squeezable baby Jesus, was the energy there. Nobody can say they weren't giving their all as both of them fought it out. Costa throwing herself around the stage like Chris Howard just enabled ragdoll physics, and Ella keeping to her side with more careful but still high energy moves. In the end though, they hugged as the audience argued amongst themselves with chants of Ella and Costa from both sides of the room. When the judges gave their verdict, it was Costa Fortune's night though, with all but Penny voting for her, which meant that sadly we would be saying farewell to Elastique. We'll get to speak to her in a bit, though. Then it was time for the remaining contestants to return to the stage so that they could find out what they would be doing next week. And oh yes, it's that time of year again, Props and Live Week. If you've somehow dodged the horror from previous years, this is where each contestant is given a random prop to utilize in their performance before immediately grabbing a microphone and having to entertain the audience live. This has tripped up more performers than stilettos and fake blood on the stage, including myself. Or was that the seagulls? Some performers can be made for live speaking, like finalist Layla Sagittaria last year, whereas others can balk under the pressure. Armed with his trusty carrier bag once again, Chris returned to let each contestant draw out their prop. Aya Quinn was landed with a cowboy hat. Better keep that Woody outfit on, I guess. Dildo would be using an Easter bucket. Or is that basket? Costa Fortune was saddled with a litter picker. Airy got a monkey onesie. Ruby got a caged teddy bear. Saturn got a candy cane, or lollipop, I guess. Vic got a flower garland. Dixon would be working with some firm buns, oh madame, which left Cherry with the booby prize. There's always one. Last year it was Mia T. Cleaver in a bicycle, and this year it would be Cherry Bomb with a ladder? Bloody hell. What the moo are they going to do with that? Well, we'll just have to wait and see, but the night wasn't over yet, as I headed upstairs to get a coveted audience with the Duchess of Mirth herself, Miss Rory.
Hello, I'm here with the fabulous Miss Rory. Now, I always get excited to speak to you because I didn't get to last year because my sister Velko interviewed you last year, which was a trial for both of you.
But... yes, it was. It was. I remember it fondly. What's she doing now? Where is she?
She's still locked in the attic.
Best way, darling. Best way, yes.
Living a best life, but no. So what are you thinking of the competition so far?
Well, you know, it gets better every year. And that sounds a bit trite to say that, but it literally does get better every year. And then when it gets to the point of sort of tonight, when you've got to sort of separate the wheat from the chaff, it's quite horrific.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you managed to send two people home last week. And then this week I was just like, I don't kind of want anyone to go home. And having Ruby and Costa in the bottom, like I didn't have that on my bingo card at all.
Well, I know. I mean, I bet you woke up on Monday morning and thought, on Sunday, will I have Ruby and Costa in my bottom? And you know.
I wish.
Yeah, well, not living your best life. No, they're all strong contenders. And it's difficult. It's very entertaining to sit and watch. It's lovely to sit and watch them all night. But then you think, oh, shit, at the end of it, we've got to crush someone.
But at least only one person went home this week. I thought it was going to be a full team going home, so I was a bit scared there.
Yeah, I mean, tonight was just cruel, wasn't it? It's the not knowing is sometimes worse than the knowing, I should imagine, for the contestants. And that sort of shake up, making them perform as a team, which is you know, fantastic for the week, but then making them go head to head with each other, and then that sort of whittling down it was brutal.
It is cool. So next week is Props Week now and Live Week. Now, this is always a bit of a make or break, I think. So what are you expecting from that?
I think that it's going to be a very strong week again. I don't think there's anybody... Is there? No. I don't think there's anybody in the competition that is going to do the and resort to, you know, sort of backward tactics on it. I think it's going to be the strongest live week that we've seen. I may be wrong, but now this is committed to tape. I will may eat my words, but I think I'll be hungry. I'll be eating no humble pie.
Well, we'll see if you're right next week. Now, you've got a wonderful new show coming out, and tickets are on sale.
Oh, tickets are now on sale. They're not on sale when we're recording this, but they will be on sale when you're watching this. Yes, I'll be back at the Time Theatre on Friday the 12th of May. It always pays to know when you're on. Friday the 12th of May at the Time Theatre with my brand new one-woman spectacular, Winging It, following hot off the heels of my sellout success last year at Land of Hope and Rory, which is brilliant. I love doing those shows, and they're much more than just a show. We try to make them a bit of a spectacular as well. And the theme this year, it's quite sort of aviation themed on the promo for it. It's not going to be a show about aeroplanes. It's a show about travel, but traveling around my world. And the second half should be particularly like, oh my God. You know, last year I had a full marching band come on stage. We sang the national anthem and Land of Hope and Rory with 800 balloons dropped from the ceiling. I thought, how are we going to top that this year? And I think we will.
I'm excited because that was melodramatic as fuck last year. I absolutely love it.
Well, it's all very self-indulgent, isn't it, Velvet? But you know, when I'm
saying... it's a one-woman show.
Well, it is.
If there was a time.
Well, yeah. But I mean, it was a bit self-indulgent having like 50-foot stamps of me behind us. But we'll see. It's going to be fun. So buy your tickets now anyway. They're available. Just go to my social media and you will find a link. Thank you.
Thank you so much for speaking to me, Miss Rory.
It's quite all right. I think I'm contractually obliged. So if that's all, I'll be off. Goodbye.
And now that the nerves were gone and the decisions were all made, I was able to chat to Team L of a Lot of Cherries, a.k.a. Cherry Bomb and Elastique.
Right. I'm here with Elastique and Cherry Bomb. Now, what was your team name again?
L of a Lot of Cherries.
And that was a very tough competition tonight. Like, how does it feel like to be in the bottom and having to lip sync?
Stressful.
It was stressful, but I think because of how close we are now, it didn't really affect her. Yeah. So
the judges were trying to catch you out, but it didn't work.
Yeah. It's sort of like, it's not going to break my bond. Definitely.
So Cherry, what was it like working together this week?
It was good. So we met up at the studio on... we were met up at Layla's on Wednesday, met at the studio this morning, and then we just rehearsed all Wednesday, all day to day. Came here early so we could see what the spacing was like. And then, but it's been good. We've worked well, I think. Yeah.
How did the idea for the number come together? Like, who first suggested burlesque?
It was sort of a joint decision last Sunday when we found out the theme. Like, I started singing Cher when we walked upstairs and I was like, oh my God.
Like,
we sort of both had an epiphany and like came up with the idea. Yeah. So.
We put the idea at Chris straight away and then it was like a case of would we change it the next day, but then we kind of stuck with it and just went with it.
Yeah, I think it's good to get an idea booked in and then even if you don't use it. Like, right, so is it a relief to have gotten through to the next round, Jerry?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a pretty succinct answer. And Ella, I'm sorry we're having to lose you from the competition.
Yes. At the end of the day, in life, you gain things and you lose things. This isn't a loss. At the end of the day, like, you don't have to win things to be successful at things. So it's something that can lead on to other things.
Well, exactly, that's it. And you're from a theatre background, aren't you?
Yes. I do musical theatre. I've done it for the past 13 years, I'm wanting to say. So I've done it for quite a few years now.
Bloody hell. No. So what's next for you and where can people find you?
So next, I've got some shows coming up. There's going to be a show next week at Whitley Bay. There's a show in a couple of weeks at Boulevard, which is for my friend's dissertation show, which I've musical directed and choreographed some things for. But I'll also be performing in drag as well. And then just university work. So that's it at the moment.
Oh, that sounds amazing. And your what's your Instagram?
My Instagram is _elastique.
Right. And Jerry, finally, your prop for next week. So any ideas so far?
None. It's a ladder.
I am so excited for what the hell this is going to be.
Me too.
Definitely.
No. Cherry Bomb, Elastique, thank you so much for speaking to me.
Thank you very much.
And that's your lot. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you haven't already, please like and share this video and follow me, The Velvet Snatch, on all my socials. With that being said, I'll see you next time for week 4 of Drag Idol 2023. See you then. Goodbye.